True, but in your first year of high school, did you do a variety of subjects that you didn't necessarily continue on with? And I'm sort of thinking how my first year of high school, we did of course the English, math, science, then languages, we did French, we did German, we actually did a tiny bit of Japanese. But the only Japanese word that I can remember was the word for trouble. And it was made up of symbols. One symbol was a house, and one symbol was a woman, and the second symbol was another woman. And it was two women under the one roof. And our Japanese teacher used to put it up because he found that very funny, which probably back then he was permitted to, but right now wouldn't be politically correct. But then we did other subjects. We did economics, we did accountancy, we did tech drawing, and other subjects that I can't remember. Oh, we did history, geography, and all those. And then in our second year of high school, we had to choose six subjects. I think English, math, science were subjects that we had to do, and then we had to pick three more subjects beyond that. One of the subjects I picked was geography. And I remember one of the very first lessons in geography, the teacher showed us a map. He put this map on a table. They asked us what we could see on the map, and we could see towns, and I think we could probably see river courses, and we looked at it. Then he got this a sheet of plastic, see-through plastic, but we could see something on that plastic, and he put it over the top of the map, and it had the topographical lines. Now, do you know what topographical lines are? So that you could work out if the land went up and when the land went down. And he explained that to us, and then we looked at it, and we could see so much more that we couldn't see in our map. Then he got another one, and he brought that one over, and that one might have been vegetation or something like that. And then he said, well, what can you see now? So we could see the bottom map, we could see the ups and the downs, the terrain, we could see the vegetation. And he was putting these sheets over, and it made me think, I'm glad I chose geography. After a year or so, I was wondering, but that first lesson really captured something in me. Now, when I read the Bible through, I, in a sense, put plastic sheets over it. And when I'm reading a passage or reading something from the Bible, as I read it, probably the first sheet I'd put over it. And it helps me just put into context what I'm reading. And I might call it the kingdom of God. And it's a big theme, and it covers and it entails God's purposes, God's plan. And so as I'm reading any passage through, I'm reading it in the context of God's overall plan. And then maybe the next sheet that I might put over. Now, I would use the word covenant, but that's a word that we're not used to, but I trust by the end of this morning it'll be a bit more so. But it would be like the laws of the kingdom, how the kingdom of God works. And so as I'm putting that over the top, and as I'm reading, I find that perhaps a passage I'm reading, I begin to see, first of all, in the context of God's overall plan, the kingdom of God. And then maybe as I'm reading it through, I begin to think too, right, how do the laws of the kingdom of God, how do they play out in this particular passage? Well, I want to take a passage, and not as just an example, but I want to take a passage because someone recently emailed me, not someone from this church, and said, look, I'm really having trouble trying to work out from Genesis 15 that where it said God spoke to Abram, and then Abram believed God, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. And the person said, I'm really having trouble understanding this, so can you just help me understand it? So I want us to just look at a tiny bit at the story of Abram, and if you do have a Bible, I just want to open it up at Genesis chapter 15, and we're going to read a little bit of that chapter through two, just turning over to it. All right, so in this early part of the story, Abram at this stage, his name hasn't been changed to Abraham, it's still Abram. He's grown up in a city in Mesopotamia called Ur. It's a pagan city, it's a pagan land, and he's left this homeland with his father, Terah, and along with his wife, Sarai, and along with his nephew, Lot. So the three of them have actually left this area, and they have moved out of the area. Now, after his father's death, God has told him to continue on to an area known as Canaan. And there God speaks to him and promises him a family through whom God will bring blessing to the nations. And that's the first part of Genesis 12. Then some years later, he still hadn't got children, God speaks to him again. And here's where I just want to pick it up in Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. It says, after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. So then God's words, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, what can you give me, since I remain childless? One who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. He was almost certainly the leading servant. And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. And the word of the Lord came to him, this man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the heavens. Count the stars. Have you ever tried to count the stars? We did as kids. Well, we tried as kids. If indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Then verse 6 says, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Now this is an amazing scripture. Abraham. But Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. So God had always wanted, and I just want to follow through a few things here. God had always wanted human beings to recognize what Abraham now knew to be true. I'm going to call him Abraham from now on, because one point is Abram, then he's Abraham, and it's going to confuse me if we go back and forth. All right, so here are a number of things that this man, even at this time, had come to know about God. The first thing, what he came to know was that he alone is God. He alone is God. Now, I mean, we may say as Christians, well, everyone knows he alone is God. But have you ever met people that act like they're little gods? There's a message that I've put up on the sign a number of times, and sometimes I think something sounds really good, and Teresa kind of looks at it, looks at me, and I think, oh, well, maybe it's not quite as good as I thought it was going to be. But this one I put up a number of times, it says, two great truths. One, there is a God. Number two, you're not him. And I want people to recognize that there is a God. There is a God. An amazing God. So this was the first thing God wanted Abram to know. Second thing that was worked into this, that the words that God speaks are a perfect reflection of who he is. They're a perfect reflection of who he is. Now our words are I won't say perfect, but they're a good reflection of who we are when our words are candid. And I don't mean when they're rehearsed or when they're memorized and we've kind of said it a certain way or we're really watching carefully, very carefully what we say. It is still so true that out of the heart, what's the next part of the verse say?
Out of the abundance.
The mouth speaks. So the words that people speak are a reflection of their heart. I remember doing a very brief section of a counseling course called neuro-linguistic something or other, I forget it now. But it was very, very much this theme that listen to people's words. And if you listen carefully enough to what people say, you'll have incredible insight into what's going on inside them. And then there are all these other ways that you can actually, as you listen, what to listen for, the kind of words, the kind of terminology people use. And then it kind of went into watch their body language and various things like that. But it was helpful to me to recognize that the more I listen to someone, the more I know what's going on inside them. How many of you have two ears? Four of you. Wonderful. How many of you have one mouth?
Yes.
All right, well, we've just doubled the number. That's really good. Two ears, one mouth. So how much listening should you be doing compared to how much? I think the penny just dropped for a few of you. All right. So the words God speaks are not just a good, they are a perfect reflection of who he is. So as I'm hearing and as Abraham heard God's words, he was hearing perfectly what this great God was like. Right? Third thing. Because God is perfectly true, perfectly honest, his words are perfectly true and perfectly honest. So not only are his words a perfect reflection of him, but because he's perfect and honest, what he speaks becomes a perfect reflection of the very God who is himself perfect. So as I'm hearing his words, it's not something that I'm not sure whether, you know, they're those words, well, are they true or not true? If God's spoken, and he's a true and perfect God, then the words that he's spoken are true and perfect. Are you still with me?
Yeah.
Good, 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 good. All right, so then we come to the next part, and this was the next part of Abraham's response. When we believe that God's words are true, we're placing faith not just in those words, but in the God who speaks them. You understand that? So when I take something from Scripture, and on the basis of Scripture, I believe God, here is a promise, and I take hold of a promise, I'm entering into this. I'll read it again. When we believe that his words, God's words are true, we're placing our faith not just in those words, but in the God who spoke those words.
Amen.
So my faith in God is going to be reflected through my faith in his words. And that's what we actually come to. Faith in God's words is faith in God. So if someone says, I have faith in God, then perhaps there are promises in Scripture. Oh, no, I don't believe that. Oh, no, 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 wait a minute. If I don't believe the words that God has spoken, and I can't put my faith and trust in the words that he's spoken, then I can't legitimately say I put my faith and trust in God. Because his words are a perfect reflection of him. So my faith and trust in his words becomes my faith and trust in him. All right? Still there.
Amen.
We're going good. So when I come to the Scripture that Abraham believed the Lord, he was placing his complete faith and his complete trust and confidence in God's words, which meant complete confidence and trust in God. So Abraham's certainty and his security were as strong as God's problems, as strong as God's promises, out of the heart and the mouth speak, as strong as God's promises. So even though for Abraham, he was going to be in part of an incredibly difficult journey, and his faith in what God had spoken to him was going to be severely tested. Because God had said that the family that will come for you one day will be as numerous as the stars you could see. And then he had said earlier that out of that family would come blessing to the nations of the earth. And we know that through that line would come the Lord Jesus Christ. And through him, ultimately, that promise would be finally fulfilled and completely fulfilled. Because the Lord Jesus would bring blessing to all the nations of the earth. All right, so that's the first half, and you've made it through. That's good, isn't it? Now, the second half, I'm going to say things that I have recently said. And don't think, I've heard this somewhere before. Doesn't Geoff know he's already told us this? How many of you, the first time a teacher explained it to you, you just got it? Well, thankfully, I don't see a single hand. And a teacher would come back and they'd say it again, and they'd say it again, and they'd say it again. And even then, some of you still didn't get it. I remember being very embarrassed by my uncle one time. I was in high school, my last year of high school, and he said to me, he said, "Geoff, so where are you up to in maths?" And I couldn't remember. I said, "Look, Uncle Charlie," I said, "I honestly can't remember." And he just laughed and said, no, come on. I mean, you're doing so many periods of maths each week, so what was the last thing you did?" I said, "Can't remember." Now, the problem was, my uncle was the Deputy Director of Education in New South Wales. His boss was the Director General of Education in New South Wales, Dr. Windham. And I think my uncle must have thought, I managed to do well in maths at the end of the year despite that absolutely mess up in front of my uncle. Alright, so now let's talk about what when I kind of talked about putting these sheets over, and I talked about putting the sheet over of covenant or the laws of the kingdom, and understanding how the laws of the kingdom operate. So when I'm reading a story, I'm putting it into a certain context. And it's that context that will really help me grab it and really help me understand it. Now, let me just read to you, first of all, if I put it in here, and I think I did, from Jeremiah chapter 31. And I'm reading from verse 31, and this, of course, is repeated in Hebrews chapter 8, verse 8. That's how we remember it. Jeremiah 31, 31, Hebrews 8, 8. It's the same root repeated. And this is what Jeremiah said. He said, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand, led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I'll put my law in their minds, write them on their hearts. I will be their God. They will be my people," which is the covenant formula. "No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. I'll forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more." So God had spoken, and he had spoken Jeremiah, we're about 600 years before Jesus is going to come as a human baby on earth. So 600 years before, God speaks through a prophet and said, even though there has been a covenant for Israel, I'm going to bring a new covenant, make a new agreement with my people here on earth. It'll be a new covenant. And then, as we read in the New Testament, we read how God had said, they in the Old Testament, under the Old Covenant, could not keep it. The problem was not the covenant. The problem was human hearts. The problem was our flesh. The problem was that we, in our fallen state, could not do what God was calling us to do. God said, so the covenant was fine, the law was fine, but the problem was the human heart. So he said, there will come a time and there will be a new covenant. And so 600 years before Jesus is even here on earth, in that sense, God speaks to him about a new covenant. So what's a covenant? Here's where we go into some things that we have talked about previously. A covenant was an agreement, usually between two parties, where each made certain promises to each other. Each time God began a new phase of his dealing with humanity, he did so through a covenant, through Adam, through Noah, through Abraham, through Israel, through David. So when God called people and they responded and said yes, they were entering into a covenant, a contract, an agreement with God. Now God's covenants were different to other human covenants or human contracts in that day, because most human contracts from those days, people would haggle out and they'd say, well, you know, you're asking me for this and you're wanting that and we're going to compromise that and change that. But when someone's going to buy a home, invariably they don't pay the price that's being asked for it. They offer a lesser price. There's a haggling. There's a working back and forth. Can we lower this? Can we change this? And so with ordinary human contracts, they could be changed. But with God's contracts, with God's covenant, they were completely different. Because when God made a covenant, when God made a covenant, he specified how the people he called to himself were to live. Now, let me just say this, too. You understand the word grace. Grace means God shows us, or anyone shows us, incredible favor, and we don't deserve it. In fact, not only do we not deserve their favor, we deserve the very opposite to their favor. And this plays out on a human level, where you may do something that's incredibly hurtful or harmful to another person, rather than getting mad and angry, they actually show you the very opposite. They show you incredible favor. And often that's even harder to take if you've ever been on the receiving end, where you've done something terrible, and someone's come, and maybe they put an arm around you, and they've done something wonderful for you, and you think, oh man, I wish they'd just smash my head in, which is what I deserve because of what I did or what I said. But they've gone to the other extreme, and that's what grace is. So when God calls us to himself, he does it by grace. He doesn't look down and see Hugo and say, oh, Hugo's been such a good, good person. So what I'm going to do, because he's been so wonderful, so good, and he's holding the camera, because he's been so wonderful and so good, I'm going to call him to my... God doesn't do that. God looks down on Hugo and says, you rotter. See, God looks down and God... Sorry, I'm so... You know, the first part worked really well, then the second part of this illustration is falling flat.
Amen.
But see, for each one of us, God doesn't call us to himself because we've been good. He calls us, everyone, to himself when we've all been bad. We've all done the wrong thing by him and by each other. And that's grace. That's grace. So when Christ called you to himself, he didn't call you to himself because you were such a wonderful person. He called you to himself in grace. But if you said yes to Christ, if when he called you, you received Christ, you put your faith and your trust in Christ, you entered into a covenant. You didn't know that at the time. They might have just said, make a decision for Christ, as Billy Graham would so often say. But you are entering into a covenant with your God, the new covenant. Not the old covenant, the new covenant. So what would happen when God would make a covenant, now that we've come to him, now that we've become his people, he would say, as part of the covenant, this is how you are to live. This is how you are to live. We often make a bit of a joke of it and say, the evangelist doesn't tell us this. And it's interesting with Israel, that Israel entered into a covenant with God at Passover time, but at some little while later that they understand all that that entails and they have to make a decision and say, well, God has called us as a nation to himself, not because we were good or brilliant or anything. God called Israel in absolute grace. And then he said, now that you're mine, this is how you are to live. This is how a covenant works. Yep, are you still with me?
Yes.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. My wife is smiling. That's a good sign. All right. So, let's go this way. They were now his people. And he was calling them to live as his people. See, people get these two, we get these two things mixed up. We say, well, if God calls me in grace, and he didn't call me because I was good enough or anything like that. Now he then says, well, this is how you're going to live. I think, oh, wait a minute. Well, why should I live this way? God says, because you're mine. You're mine now. You're mine. You become mine. I called you. You receive that call. You receive Christ into your life. You receive Christ. You put your faith and your trust that when Jesus went to the cross and died, he was taking your sin upon himself. You believe that. You invited Christ into your life. And now God says, when you did that, that was grace. And then you became part of my people. Now I'm telling you, as my people, this is how I want you to live. Because you entered into a covenant. You made a covenant. You said yes to a covenant agreement. And so God came down to, and I've got an illustration in mind, and I'm sure it's going to fall flat. But anyway, that's faith, isn't it? Many, many, many years back, when Centrelink was a little room, not much larger than our kitchen, I remember that, and it had a little tiny desk. And I remember going in town to fill in some paperwork, and they said to me, "Oh, we just see here, you haven't applied for the parenting allowance." And I said, "What's that?" And they said, "Well, the government wants to pay you," and it sounded like an extraordinary amount of money back then. Extraordinary amount of money. And I said, "Well, what do I have to do for that?" And they said, "Well, you've already done it, you're a parent. All right, you've got children. So there is a new allowance the government is bringing in." And from memory, it was like the amount of money back then sounded absolutely extraordinary. And I said, "Well, so I just have to say yes." And they said, "Yeah, you just have to virtually tick the box and we've got all the other information and then you start getting the payment." And I said, "This is too good to be true." I didn't say that out loud. I thought it in my head. And then I said, "Is there any catch?" Which, you know, you don't say that to assembly people now. I did then, and they said, "Look, the only thing is that the government then has the right to look at all of your finances." And I said, "Oh, you mean like just looking at how much money you've got in the bank and money coming in, going out?" And I said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, that's fine, just tick, tick, tick." And I said, "Ipswich people must be just falling over backwards to get this payment." They said, "Oh, no, they said Ipswich people don't want anyone knowing how much they've got in the bank. They especially don't want the government knowing." And at that stage, there'd been something like a 12 or 13% of Ipswich people who could get that allowance initially went in for it, and the other, whatever it is, 87% said, "We don't want the government knowing what's going on, thank you." All right, so, but what I'm saying is this, it was there if you would take it, but there was a condition. But the condition only applied once you became part of those who were recipients of it. Can you just see, and illustrations worked best when I thought them through, and that one I hadn't. All right, so God's covenants were all one-sided. Actually, I've jumped ahead about myself, but let me jump ahead of myself. God's covenants were all one-sided. God said, "This is how it's going to be. Accept it or don't accept my call." See, there'll be people who say, "I want to be a Christian." "Oh, that's great, you know, just receive Christ and then you live your life for Him." Wait a minute, what do you mean I live my life for Him? Well, yeah, because you come before the great God. You've said, I'll become one of those great God's people here on earth. So now the life you live is going to reflect Him. Isn't that exciting? No, it's not. Wait a minute, but like, you know what I mean? I've got to stop sleeping around. Yeah. You know what I mean? I've got to stop doing drugs. Yeah, that'll all come into it. And then I go through, and I've heard so many stories where people have said, I'll think about this. Because they've suddenly realized that to be one of God's people, the Spirit of God will begin to change things in you. Whoa, I'm not sure about that. And so this is how a covenant works. God calls you in grace, but when you say yes to Him, this is wonderful. You're now my God, I'm part of your people. Then the Spirit of God says, now I'm going to begin changing you because now this covenant is not negotiable. The covenant's black and white. It isn't a negotiable covenant. God says, take it or leave it, but I'm not going to change it. I'm not going to change it. All right, so each of the covenants, see what we're up to here. They had conditions and they had promises. How many of you have a Bible with you? Some people hold up a little phone. Here's my little Bible. All right. Does your Bible have an Old Testament and a New Testament? All right. By and large, the Old Testament in your Bible is the Old Covenant. By and large. The New Testament is the New Covenant. So if I'm saying, well, wait a minute, Geoff, you're just saying that there are two great sections to the Bible. Yeah, I am. And I'm saying the Old Testament is principally the Old Covenant, and the New Testament is entirely the New Covenant. So if I'm trying to work out, well, God, you know, these conditions, these promises, where do I find them? You find them in your New Testament. And as I open up the New Testament, I'm opening up the New Covenant. I'm finding what are the conditions for being God's people. I'm finding what are the promises He gives to me as being God's people. I find that in the New Testament. I find it in the New Testament. So my Bible will have both. Our Bible divided into two. So when you receive Christ, you entered into the New Covenant with God. A covenant that has conditions and a covenant that has promises. So we are to live by what we read in the New Testament because it's the New Covenant. Sometimes people show me a scripture from the Old Testament and they say, well, it says here that I'm meant to be doing this, this, and this. And I say, that's under the Old Covenant, you're under the New Covenant. Oh, you're saying I don't have to do that. And I'm saying you do have to follow the New Covenant. I'm not saying because there are some things in the old that have come over to the new, and there is much from the old covenant that has not come over to the new. But sometimes people will just quote an Old Testament scripture, and then I say, now, has that been brought into the new covenant or not? If it hasn't, then I'd say, just leave it there. You're a new covenant Christian. Every Christian is a new covenant Christian. There's no such thing in that sense as an old covenant Christian in that sense. So if I'm looking at scriptures from the Old Testament, and as much as I love the patterns and I love to see how God brought it forth to where it is, and I would spend an enormous amount of time, and my knowledge of the Old Testament is reasonably strong, but as I'm looking at all that, it's the New Covenant that I stand in. I am a child of the New Covenant. I'm not a child of the Old Covenant. So if I'm saying, well, God, what do you expect of me? I simply have to open up my New Testament and I begin to read it. I was going to say, is that okay? But it's not negotiable. Even if you said, no, it's not, I'd say, you're wrong. All right. So under the New Covenant, we are, and we've talked about this, we've talked about most of this second part previously, only a couple of weeks back. But under the New Covenant, the two principal conditions, there are conditions and there are promises within each covenant. And the two principal conditions are faith and obedience. Faith and obedience. Sometimes people say it's faith and faithfulness, but to me, people then get them mixed up. So I say it's faith and obedience. Trust, faith, and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to
trust
and obey. Trust, faith, obey. Faith, obedience. Faith, obedience. The two principal conditions of the New Covenant are faith and obedience. So our faith and obedience, and we just say the opposite to faith or the opposite to belief is? It's there on the screen.
Unbelief.
Opposite to obedience is?
Disobedience.
So faith and obedience bring God's blessing. Unbelief and disobedience mean God can withdraw His blessing. You understand that?
Yes.
I had someone come up to me a little bit confused when I explained it a couple of weeks back, and they said, oh, it kind of came over like, you know, God judges me when I do the wrong thing. I said, no, there's a big difference between God lifting His restraint and God actually, in that sense, causing something to happen to you. And then a couple of weeks back, I used the example of Israel for lamb and all the trouble that's come. There is a sense in which God honors your choice. And if someone makes a choice to go in a certain pathway, there are consequences for that choice. So when we face the consequences for our choice, we say, God, you made this happen. But God says, no, I didn't. You made it happen. Mm-hmm. I wanted you to follow my will. I said to you, I wanted you to say to me, thy will be done. You refused that, so I just said to you, thy will be done. You want to do it your way, fine, but there are consequences. So when we face the consequences, we can't then say, God, you made that happen. Sometimes God just lifts His hand and we face the consequences. Sometimes there can be consequences that God very graciously intervenes and we don't have to face. Sometimes. Sometimes, and I've had situations like that, where God just very graciously came in and brought back a restraint. But there are other times when I've gone in a pathway contrary to His pathway, and He simply lifted His restraint and let me get into trouble because I've done the wrong thing. And I can't blame Him. Say, God, I'm a Christian. How could you, I'm going to say, let this happen? And He said, my son, you let it happen. Don't blame me for all of your muck-ups. Come on, that was your muck-up. There were consequences. Sometimes I will restrain you anyway, but other times you say, you want it your way, fine. I lift my restraint. You keep on going in that pathway. There are consequences. All right, when I begin to blame God and say, God, in all this, I'm just a victim. And we take on the victim mentality, don't we? How often we hear of that. Some of you would have seen the case recently where a guy in America is suing his parents for a phenomenal amount of money because they were white and he wanted to be black. So, like, it's all his parents' fault. All right, so, our faith, almost finished, our faith and obedience unto God's word. Because faith in God's word is faith in Him. Obedience to God's word is obedience to Him. So God wants me and wants you to fulfill the conditions of the new covenant, as I said, principally and summarized into faith and obedience, and to take hold of the promises of the new covenant. And our certainty and our security as children of the new covenant are as strong as the promises of God. So I'm taking the promises of God in my New Testament, reading them through, I'm taking hold of them, and I'm saying, these are your amazing promises to me. And so knowing those promises, I take hold of those promises. Now, let me just close with this. A couple of weeks back, after a Sunday, it had been a sort of slightly difficult Sunday morning meeting in some ways, and I was...